Hello, my friend. Welcome to your sleep story. My name is Stephen Dalton, and it's my great privilege to be the voice that you listen to as you go to sleep tonight. In tonight's story, we start a new series, a series where we imagine a day in the life of a great artist from the past. Tonight we follow Ernest Hemingway, who lived in Paris in the 1920s. If this video helps you, as always, please do hit the like button. If you would like to suggest other stories or to share with me your own stories, please do comment. And finally, if you're not subscribed yet to the channel, and you're using the channel often, please do hit the subscribe button. These three things will keep us making stories for you for a very long time to come. Now, before we join Hemingway on a Paris day in the 1920s, let's do a little relaxation session. Just to get you nice and relaxed. So, feeling the support of the bed or floor beneath you. Really feeling that support. And beneath that, the earth, our home. The one place we all have in common. Whatever has been today has been. Whatever will be, will be. Right now, you deserve this moment to listen to the sound of my voice and enjoy a beautiful story. So just notice your breath as it enters and leaves your body. And now, when you're ready, take a deep breath in through your nose, bringing in a healing, calming energy. And let go. Letting go of anything unwanted, unnecessary. One more breath in through your nose. And let go. Releasing. Now, imagine with your eyes closed as you lie comfortably in bed, a little light in the middle of your body. You choose the color. This light brings peace, brings calm, brings healing, brings safety wherever it goes. And allow yourself to watch that light grow and grow throughout your body, from your chest into your stomach, and as it moves and moves kindly offering you the opportunity for rest from anything that may be troubling you. Enjoy this moment. Any and all tension is lifted by this light, in your feet, in your hands. Your feet have worked hard for you today. Let the light offer them rest. Your hands have worked hard for you today. Let the light offer them peace. Into your neck and head, any tension you're holding in your face, let it go now. And now just allow that light to be within you, a constant friend, remembering always that you are safe as I take you to Paris in the 1920s. Ernest Hemingway was born in 1899. In Illinois. He was a journalist and a novelist and would go on to become one of the 20th century's most influential writers. He was a Nobel Prize laureate, and in the early 1920s, following a stint as a journalist in Toronto, Hemingway moved to Paris with his first wife, Adley Richardson. Now, Paris during this time was a great hub for artists, writers, and intellectuals, and Hemingway quickly found himself to be part of what became known as the Lost Generation. He spent his days in Paris writing, socializing with other writers like F. Scott Fitzgerald and James Joyce. He would later chronicle his time in Paris in a great book called A Movable Feast. We join him on a spring morning in 1925. The Paris air is tinged with the soft scent of cherry blossoms as Hemingway sits at a small wrought iron table of a café near Jardin du Luxembourg. His eyes flit from the passers-by to the notebook in front of him, a small reservoir of thoughts and observations. He sips his coffee, a strong, no-nonsense brew that wakes him up better than the morning sun, now casting dappled patterns through the café's awning. People watching seems like a sport to him, an endless source of characters and storylines. An elderly man shuffles past, the lines on his face deep as trenches, pulling behind him a lifetime of stories Hemingway can only guess at. A young couple strolls arm in arm, love new and blooming, a contrast to the older couples sitting on park benches, whose love has settled into comfortable silence. As he observes, Hemingway occasionally scribbles in his notebook sentences, fragments, and ideas that drift through his mind like fallen leaves on the River Seine. He isn't sure where these ideas will fit in the greater puzzle of his work, but he trusts his process, knowing that sometimes a single line can inspire an entire story. His thoughts wander to his friends, other writers and artists populating this city of lights. Gertrude Stein, Fitzgerald, Joyce, they're all here, mingling ideas and debates over wine and whiskey. Ernest sits and breathes in this moment. He is grateful for the life he leads, living among intellects and dreamers. He treasures these solitary moments of reflection. For him, writing is a solitary act, a one-on-one battle between him and the blank page. Setting down his coffee cup, he decides that the day is too beautiful to be spent entirely in contemplation. Gathering his notebook and pen, he prepares to venture out, he decides to go towards Shakespeare and Company, the great bookshop. As he stands, he takes one last sweeping gaze at the cafe and the surrounding scene, a snapshot of life that will, in some way, be a part of his writing as he captures the essence of this remarkable city in this remarkable time. He slips his notebook into his pocket and adjusts his hat. He walks, emboldened by the morning's observations and caffeine. The walk toward Shakespeare and Company is one he's made countless times, but it never gets old. Each journey is a parade of sights and sounds, both familiar and newly intriguing. Street vendors hawk fresh bread and flowers, the aromatic blend of yeast and blooms mingling in the air, comforting in its simple beauty. As he walks, he crosses the Pont Saint-Michel, pausing for a moment to look out over the River Seine. The river's surface is a mosaic of shimmering light and shadow. He watches as a boat glides silently beneath the bridge, its wake sending ripples across the water. Hemingway thinks about how life's moments are a little like those ripples, interconnected yet fleeting, a thought he tucks away for later reflection. As he walks the streets of Paris, he sometimes thinks of it like a grand open-air library. The walls seem to whisper the legacies of the great thinkers and revolutionaries who have walked here before him. Soon, he arrives at Shakespeare and Company. This bookstore is a haven, smelling of old paper and endless possibilities. Its shelves are filled with literary treasures, each book a world in itself, waiting to be explored. Hemingway feels a sense of homecoming every time he steps inside this sanctuary of words. He's greeted by Sylvia Beach, the proprietress, with the warm familiarity reserved for regular patrons and fellow devotees of literature. She suggests a few new arrivals, but Ernest is keen on revisiting some classics today. He picks up a worn copy of Tolstoy's Anna Karenina, a book he's read before, but wants to experience afresh. As he holds it in his hands, the thought comes to him that great stories are timeless and their truths resonate through generations. It's an aspiration he holds for his own work, a quiet prayer that hums in the back of his mind as he heads towards the counter to make his purchase. After leaving Shakespeare and Company, Hemingway goes back the way he just came and decides to visit Gertrude Stein's salon at 27 Rue de Fleurus. His walk there is a shift from the literary quietude of the bookstore. As he makes his way through the streets, his thoughts drift to the dialogues that will unfold in that living room of Gertrude's. And as he walks, he looks at the many faces of the many Parisians he encounters. Each life, each human, a deep well of inspiration, he thinks. Each story, a valid one. No one more or less important than the other. He arrives and is greeted warmly by Gertrude Stein herself, who ushers him in to the gathering with the air of a ringmaster. The atmosphere is imbued with the smoky richness of pipe tobacco and the depth of conversations that cross borders and bend the fabric of traditional thought. He spots Pablo Picasso, engrossed in conversation with F. Scott Fitzgerald. This type of meeting of visual and literary artistry something that could only happen in Gertrude Stein's house. Hemingway takes a seat and joins in the discussion. His keen ears tuning in to the multiple conversations. As the evening progresses, Ernest finds himself in a tête-à-tête with James Joyce, a man whose work he deeply respects. They discuss the complexities and the simplicities of human nature, of love and war. They even discuss their work methods. The two souls feel invigorated by this meeting of minds. The day goes on and on, and before anyone knows it, the clock has struck midnight. It's time that Hemingway makes his way back home. And as he walks through the sleepy streets of Paris, the conversations have left him inspired, eager to transfer this renewed energy onto paper. Upon reaching his modest apartment in the Latin Quarter, Hemingway feels a sense of calm wash over him. He hangs his coat and hat on the stand by the door. His wife is asleep. The room is simple and unadorned, yet it is a sanctuary for him. He sits at his writing desk. He flips open his notebook and, picking up his pen, he starts to write. The words flow effortlessly, almost as if they have a life of their own. Each sentence forming, breaking, and reforming, until it stands stark and true. There's a meditative quality to this process, a peaceful solitude that centers him as his pen dances across the paper. The characters in his stories come alive, each one a mirror, reflecting some facet of human emotion or experience. Finally, he becomes very tired and extinguishes the lamp on his desk. He gets into bed and slowly sleep starts to claim him. And so, under the soft embrace of the Parisian night, in the spring of 1925, Ernest Hemingway happily drifts off to sleep. His mind already crafting the stories that will fill the pages of tomorrow.